Good afternoon. I'm Arapahoe County Sheriff Dave Walcher. Thank you for being here today as we bring to closure our criminal investigation of the homicide and attempted homicides at Arapahoe High School that occurred on December 13th, 2013. I would like to introduce several people that are here today. Most importantly, Michael and Desiree Davis. They're in the center of the individual sitting over here. The Davises do not want to be interviewed, and I would demand that you respect their wishes. On a personal note, I have met with the Davises numerous times and have spoken with them countless times regarding this investigation to keep them informed and to hear their concerns and feedback regarding certain aspects of this case. I do want to say thank you publicly to the Davises for working with the Arapahoe County Sheriff's Office, and I'm deeply sorry for your loss. Our 18th Judicial District Attorney, George Brockler, is here today, and he will provide some comments, as will the Superintendent of the Littleton Public Schools, Scott Murphy. I also want to acknowledge Mayor Kathy Noon from the City of Centennial, who is our partner in providing law enforcement services to the City of Centennial, and I appreciate the City's support. The purpose of today is to provide insight to the criminal investigation that was conducted by the Arapahoe County Sheriff's Office into the murder of Claire Esther Davis and the attempted murder of Tracy Murphy and a student at Arapahoe High School on December 13th, 2013. I also want to mention a few things that the Arapahoe County Sheriff's Office have done since December 13th to enhance public safety in Arapahoe County. You'll receive today a copy of the investigative report, which is now posted on our website. It's been emailed to our media outlets, and it's also been sent out to our citizens groups. It is a 37-page summary that is supported by approximately 4,000 pages of documents, over 200 interviews, 13 search warrants, 3 production of records requests, processing of numerous crime scenes, over 200 items of evidence collected, the analysis of that evidence, over 3,000 images and photos that have been archived, downloading and review of 911 calls, downloading and review of recorded radio traffic, review of high school surveillance video, review of school records, and follow-up on tips that have been received by the Arapahoe County Sheriff's Office. The investigation revealed the following. And can you still hear me okay? This is a floor plan of Arapahoe High School as it appeared on December 13th, 2013. Carl Pearson parked his vehicle in a fire lane on the north side of the school in the area up here. That happened at about 12:32 p.m. on December 13th. There was a maintenance employee of Littleton Public Schools who was outside near this boiler room area who observed Carl Pearson running to the door with a shotgun and who got on the radio and alerted staff as to what he had seen. And that individual's name is Fabian Elanos, and he did state that there was a shooter outside. This was incredibly important to alert staff as to what was occurring, and what he did, what Fabian did, was put into motion the lockdown procedures that this school had practiced. Pearson entered through what we refer to as the north doors in that area right there, and Claire Davis and one other student was seated on a bench in that area right there. When Mr. Pearson came into the school, and simultaneously, Claire said, "Carl, what are you doing?" Claire knew Carl, knew of Carl. Pearson fired 3 rounds toward Claire and the other student. The first round missed both students. The second round hit Claire in the head. And the third round ricocheted, and these are shotgun rounds, the third round ricocheted off of a brick wall and hit Claire in the back. The other student was not injured. There was also one misfeed on the part of Pearson in that shotgun, as we found a live shotgun shell that it had been ejected from that shotgun in
in what we call the trophy hallway, which is this long north to south hallway right there. Pearson went around the corner at that door and into the library, which is right there. The radio, and I need to talk a little bit further about this. He goes into the library, and Mr. Tracy Murphy was in the library, and Mr. Murphy made an attempted to exit the library through an outside exit door. Pearson fired two rounds at Murphy, and he missed. During Mr. Murphy's interview, he stated that he thinks Pearson would follow him out into the parking lot, and he would be able to play a game, and in essence, cat and mouse, until law enforcement arrived. Pearson stayed in the library. Mr. Murphy was not injured. Mr. Murphy was picked up in a vehicle by Fabian, that same maintenance worker that alerted the school about what was going on outside, and they departed that immediate area in Fabian's vehicle. There were other students and staff in that library that were able to either escape the library or hide in the library. At the same time all of this is occurring, I have to explain a couple things. Number one, we have a school resource officer that is in the school, James Engler, at that time, and he has several radios with him. He has his sheriff's office portable radio, and he also has a school radio. That sheriff's office radio, all the radio traffic on that is recorded. School radios are not recorded. And you can imagine the right when this starts, you can imagine the amount of radio traffic as the deputy is trying to get out on the radio of what is occurring in the school. You have a chaotic scene within that school with a lot of noise, and it is very difficult to hear any radio traffic at all. So I will describe the actions of some of the other people involved. As soon as this comes out on the radio, there are two Littleton Public School District security officers that are in this area near the cafeteria, this commons area. They come down the north hallway toward the library. At this time, Pearson is in that library. They come up to the door of the library, look in, and both stated that they see Pearson in the library, alive. They exit that area here and go to a south hallway away from the library. Simultaneously and within seconds, Deputy James Englert and Littleton Public School security officer also coming down this hallway. Deputy Englert stated that he did not know really what was happening and where. He knew the school was on lockdown, but he really was unclear as about the specific location, but he knew he needed to go towards the library and think about a very chaotic scene and think about the difficulty in hearing radio traffic and trying to understand what is going on. Him and Rod Muller, the Littleton Public School security officer, go down the what we call the north hallway toward the library. Deputy Englert sees a haze or smoke somewhere in this area where the trophy hallway and the north hallway meet. As they approach that area, they still do not know what is occurring and where. Deputy Englert stated that he kept yelling for people to tell him, where is the shooter, where is the shooter, but he did not know what was going on. They were listening for shots at that time and they did not hear any further shots. So they were walking into a blind situation. When they got near the trophy hallway, Deputy Englert and Rod Muller observed what turned about to be Claire Esther Davis lying on the hallway floor in the trophy hallway next to the bench. They approached her, still not knowing where our active shooter was. Assistant Principal Daryl Meredith arrived on scene in that particular area over here, and there was a quick discussion about Claire. Deputy Engler told Daryl Meredith and Rob Muller to carry Claire south in the trophy hallway, that direction, to the set of doors down here by a study area. The thinking was, and it was proper, that that would be the absolute quickest way for Claire to receive medical help, is getting her to a location where she could be picked up. So she was carried down there by Rod Mahler and Assistant Principal Dara Meredith. Also in the area at the same time, Assistant Principal Kevin Colossa was in the area. And when Pearson was in the library, after he fired at Tracy Murphy, he lit and threw a Molotov cocktail, which did start a fire in the library. Kevin Colossa, still unclear as to what was happening and where, went into that library and ultimately saw the fire, found water to put out that fire, and ultimately the fire was extinguished. And then Mr. Colossa hid in the library with the assistant librarian because they had still not seen the shooter. A few minutes later, two more of our deputies arrived on scene. Deputies Brash and Mason. They came in the door, the north door, the same one that was entered by the shooter, and met up with Deputy James Engler in that very area near the library. It was determined by Deputy Engler that they need to go into the library, which they did. Two of the three deputies went in, including Deputy Engler. They went into the library, and ultimately, the assistant librarian and Kevin Colossa told them that the shooter was Carl Pearson, but they did not know where Carl Pearson was at that moment in time. Ultimately, through a check of the library, they did locate Carl Pearson with a apparent self-inflicted gunshot wound to the head. They pushed the shotgun away from him for officer safety reasons, and they called in the Arapahoe County Sheriff's Office bomb squad to check the rest of the building, the location around Carl Pearson and the rest of the library and ultimately the building for any explosive devices or incendiary devices, which they found none. The rest of the school was evacuated, cleared and evacuated for other suspects, and no other devices were located and without further incidents. Claire was transported to Littleton Adventist Hospital in a matter of minutes, and she did pass away 8 days later on December 21st, 2013. That's what happened the day of. So let's go back a little bit in time and start talking about a little bit about the investigation. On a computer that was seized from the Pearson home via search warrant, we discovered a 28-page diary that was written by Carl Pearson that began on September 17th. In looking at this case, it appears clearly that Carl Pearson was angry, in fact, very angry. It also appears that his anger goes back a long time, and to quote from his diary in the very first entry, which was dated September 17th, this is a quote, "a 10-year subconscious project for me to exact revenge, not on the individuals who perpetrated wrong, but instead by those I believe had done me wrong," end quote. Additionally, he stated, "I will shoot up my school, Arapahoe High School, before the year is over." That entry was September 17th. While we will not be releasing the diary in its entirety, there are about 2 pages of relevant excerpts from that diary in the summary investigative report that explain his thinking leading up to the events of December 13th. In consideration of the Davis family, the Pearson family, the Arapahoe High School community, and our community as a whole, I do not think it would serve the public interest by releasing the diary in its entirety. Additionally, I certainly don't want Pearson's writings to be used to inspire others in the future. Pearson had some prior disciplinary issues in the school, to include a suspension in the spring of 2013 for statements that he made in a math class. Pearson was removed from being the captain of the extemporaneous team, which is a subset of the speech and debate team, on Tuesday, September 3rd, by Tracy Murphy. That prompted an outburst by Pearson at the school that resulted in him being kept home for several days, a threat assessment being done, and a re-entry meeting being done on September 9th. The Sheriff's Office did take an informational report regarding the September 3rd outburst on September 5th, which was the day we were notified of that outburst. The threat assessment indicated Pearson was a low level of concern. Barbara Pearson also advised us that Carl was assessed
at a behavioral health center on September 9th and was told that Carl was not a threat to himself or others. There's not a lot of school information regarding Carl Pearson between mid-September and mid-December. He legally purchased his shotgun on December 6th and purchased additional items related to this crime on December 13th, the day of the shooting. He was asked to leave a class on December 11th and was showing his shotgun or pictures of his shotgun to others after the purchase. None of the students interviewed in all of this investigation knew of Pearson's plan. The vast majority of the investigation was done months ago, but there are two specific items of evidence that needed to be analyzed by other organizations beyond the capability of the Arapahoe County Sheriff's Office Crime Lab. Both were critical to the thoroughness and completeness of this investigation. Let me go over those two very briefly. On January 2nd, we requested the Colorado Bureau of Investigation to do an analysis of the shotgun that was recovered in the library. CBI requested additional evidence from us as part of that analysis, which was provided to them. On September 4th, we received the report from CBI that indicated the following. First, the shotgun was capable of firing. Second, all of the shotgun shells that were recovered from the scene were fired from the shotgun that was recovered. And lastly, the shotgun shell shot size, trajectories, and patterns of impact are consistent with the processing of the crime scene and witness statements. Inasmuch as there was no video in the library, this is critical to establish that no one else was involved and there were no other firearms used. The other item of evidence that needed to be examined by another organization was an ACES tablet that was recovered from the Pearson residence through a search warrant affidavit. The tablet was submitted to the Rocky Mountain Regional Computer Forensics Lab for forensic analysis in December. Their efforts to see what was on that tablet was unsuccessful, and the tablet was sent to the FBI's Cryptologic and Electronic Analysis Unit in Quantico, Virginia. We did a request to rush on the processing of the tablet, but that request was denied due to the fact that the suspect, in this case, was deceased, we felt, and there was no indication of anyone else's involvement at that time. On September 9th, we received a report detailing the analysis of the tablet. Relevant information from the tablet included several photographs taken on December 13th, to include photos of Carl Pearson, taken by himself, wearing the same clothes that he was wearing when he was found in the library, and the gun, machete, and ammunition. After finding the diary that I previously mentioned, the tablet was concerning to us as we needed to ensure that there was no one else involved in the planning or actual event on December 13th, and there was not. Related to both of these items, the shotgun and the tablet, I decided not to disclose those items and the reason for the delay in processing these items, as it could have potentially been detrimental to our investigation if there was anyone else identified as being involved. As it turned out, it's clear no one else was involved. We fully understand that many people will want to review additional documents related to this investigation. And for the most part, any documents related to this investigation are considered criminal justice records, and we have a responsibility to thoroughly review these records before their release. As I have stated, the records associated with this investigation are voluminous. However, our records staff and attorney's office are actively engaged in the process, and we intend to make available any records that can be released once that review is complete. After the last pieces of information were obtained, we presented the summary report to the district attorney's office for review and received their letter as to their disposition or findings on Monday, October 6th, this week. District Attorney George Brockler will speak to his findings or opinion in a few moments. Moving forward, I firmly believe that we can all and should learn from this tragedy. Shame on us if we do not learn from this, and I'm committed to that philosophy. So let me tell you briefly a few things that we have done since December 13th at the Arapahoe County Sheriff's Office. We have added a second school resource officer at Arapahoe High School. This was possible by the generosity of the Littleton Public Schools agreeing to fund one half of our SROs, or school resource officers, that serve their district. Through two of our funding authorities, the City of Centennial and Arapahoe County, we are requesting to double the number of our SROs in our service area to provide more school resource officer coverage at high schools, middle schools, elementary schools, and private schools. We have participated in the development of common response protocols for law enforcement agencies and all the school districts in our service area in Arapahoe County at the Arapahoe County Sheriff's Office. Additional training we've conducted this summer related to active shooter response has been conducted, and that is in the urban areas of the county. In the rural areas of the county, we have worked with our two school districts in the east part of the county in Deer Trail and Byers, and the responding law enforcement and fire agencies to train for active shooters. And lastly, and that's not all we've done, but lastly in this, we've done security surveys of numerous schools in an attempt to help them with design and response improvement based upon what we learned at Arapahoe High School. You'll receive a copy of the investigative report today. It is now posted. We have emailed that out to our news media, and it has been sent out to our email groups at the Sheriff's Office as of 3 p.m. today. Additionally, I would add, Michael and Desiree Davis gave me a written statement that they would also like to have posted, and that also has been sent out, I believe, at 3 o'clock to our news media groups.